Welcome to Italics.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Your debut novel, 2 a.m. at the Cat's Pajamas, it features the interwoven stories of a few characters. We have Madeleine, who aspires to be a jazz singer and is a 9-year-old girl. We have Sarina, her teacher, who is hoping to reconnect with a romantic interest. And we have Jack Lorca, the owner of the jazz club, the Cat's Pajamas, who needs to save his club because it's in danger of being closed. But I wanted to start off by asking you about the city where these stories all take place,
sure.
Which is Philadelphia. So can you tell us a little bit about your personal connection to the city and also your decision to use it as the setting?
Well, I grew up in Northeast Philadelphia, and my parents are from South Philadelphia, both of them, in a very thriving Italian-American community in that neighborhood that unfortunately is no longer as thriving. So I grew up kind of far out of the city, almost on the line of the suburbs, hearing stories about how wonderful it was to live in South Philadelphia, where several cousins and aunts and uncles and grandparents would be living on the same block. And the romanticization of that idea that I learned and heard over and over in these stories made me really love the idea of setting a story there, especially one where every character kind of had its say. And the point of view literally takes a walk, kind of in the improvisational way of music and jazz that the book is also about, into the heads of several passersby. And as I was doing that, as I would let the point of view walk from person to person, this other voice bubbled up, and toward the end of the novel, you realize that it's actually the voice of Philadelphia that begins to speak. If you know anything about Philadelphia, you would know that it was kind of a matter of time before that city would start to make its views known. It's not really a city that takes the back burner very often, so
right.
I think about it now and I think, oh, that was inevitable, that Philadelphia would say, okay, all of these people are great, but I want to tell my own story now.
And I like that the book begins with an epigraph from David Lynch about the possibilities in Philadelphia to have sort of a door into another world. And I think that works perfectly with the characters in your book who have these various hopes and aspirations.
David Lynch is a huge inspiration to me. His work walks that amazing line between gritty reality and surrealism, as mine tends to do as well. And David Lynch spent many formative years in Philadelphia. He was a student at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts, and they actually just recently had a retrospective of his work there. And he has a lot of ambivalent quotes about
sure.
Philadelphia that I think really get the charm and grit of that city very well. And one of them I used for the epigraph, which is, yes, Philadelphia is horrible, but in a very interesting way.
And the location that you mentioned where your family is from,
mm-hmm.
that is also where Madeline lives in the book, is that correct? Is that my geography correct? There?
You got it, that's totally correct. She lives in the Italian Market, which is on South 9th Street in Philadelphia, and that's around where my parents grew up. It's this really beautiful place that sells produce and meat and cheeses and now has a lot of cute boutique restaurants, these days. And the 9th Street Market is also where you might know it from the movie Rocky.
Of course.
He's running through the 9th Street Market during, the montage of his training. And it's a funny story about that I heard when I was researching this book, that during that scene when he's running through the market, someone throws a tomato at him in the movie.
Oh,
As part of the film, but it turns out that actually wasn't scripted.
Well,
a South
there
Philadelphia.
You go. A true moment in South Philadelphia, perhaps.
Like I said, it wasn't long before a Philadelphian probably thought to himself, who's this guy running down our street? I'm going to throw a tomato at him.
So that idea of running relates to another thing that you alluded to earlier, is the movement throughout the city that takes place in the novel,
mm-hmm.
And also how that connects to the role of music and specifically jazz in the novel.
When I was still living in Philadelphia, I would go and hear jazz all the time. And there's a jazz club called Warm Daddies that's on Front Street that's still there. And one night, a couple musician friends and I went to Warm Daddies and participated in this amazing veteran jazz musician open mic. so that you could go up and play with these guys who've been playing together for years and years. It's very daunting. And I sat and watched as my friends went on stage and did that. And it was just one of those amazing nights where everyone was in a good mood, the music sounded amazing, the drinks were great. And I remember when we were leaving and I was going home, I thought to myself, I want to write a story that feels the way this night feels. In that it's not going to change any of our lives. It's not a night where, you know, a meteor comes crashing to Earth and everybody perishes. It's just one of those great nights that you have at the end of which your life goes back to being pretty much the same, but you've had this really great experience. So I wanted to market the book by saying, this is, if you think about it, a night where not much happens, but surprisingly enough, the publishers decided to go a different way.
Well, one of the things that does really come across is the spirit of the book, this love of life and joy.
Oh, good.
Even though, as you say, really nothing changes for the characters, except maybe Mrs. Santiago, perhaps, at the end.
Perhaps.
But there is that feeling of joy at the end of the book, which is beautiful.
I definitely wanted to include every human emotion I possibly could, and I feel many times joy is left out of that in a lot of contemporary novels. It's difficult to write about joy, because you run the risk of coming off as saccharine. But I think, or at least I tried to balance it with some real life tragedies and sadnesses. When we leave Madeleine in the book, I would not say we leave her in a very good place.
Right.
She has a hard road to hoe.
Right.
However, she's had this glimmer, this moment of magic that will hopefully sustain her throughout the hard times ahead.
What was it like to have a character that is a child?
Child protagonist was tricky, and I don't think I ever would have guessed that I would write one. I wasn't particularly interested in a child protagonist. However, a long time ago, I wrote a poetry cycle, I'm embarrassed to admit, about jazz dancers coming home after a fun night. And these two dancers, they didn't have names. It was very much, you know, the early stages of everything. They were coming home in Philadelphia, and their antics, they were carrying on, basically, and singing and yelling, and their antics wake up this little girl in this courtyard who comes out of her apartment and has this kind of cute J.D. Salinger-esque, profound, in a way, conversation with these jazz dancers. And I remember thinking, what kind of little girl would crawl out of her apartment and be able to hold her own
right.
with these kind of world-weary, eccentric figures? And that was obviously Madeleine, and I realized I was very interested in a little girl who would do that. And she actually helped me write her, because she turned out to be really foul-mouthed, chain-smoking, uninterested in having friends,
right.
uninterested in being a bully, because she doesn't like having weak people around, is what I actually ended up, I believe that line was. And so I basically took out any chance that she could be too cloying or cute.
And I love the scene where the bully, I believe his name is Dennis, knocks over her caramel apple, which leads to her expulsion.
Oh, right. Yeah.
The way that the scene takes place, it kind of feels like a slow motion. You know, you know something bad is about to happen for Madeleine. This is not going to end well. But it's so satisfying.
It's very satisfying because she clocks him in the nose.
Of course.
She is very much a wish I made. I didn't have her bravado. I didn't have her courage. I was very, very shy when I was growing up. So Madeleine was the girl I kind of wish I was.
And speaking of Madeleine, her last name is Altimari, an Italian last name, and there are a few characters with Italian last names in the book. And is that something that was incidental, or is that related to the fact that the book does take place in Philadelphia and some of these Italian-American neighborhoods?
It was. It was definitely reflective of that South Philadelphia neighborhood where she is from. I think that ethnically the book is quite diverse,
mm-hmm.
and I tried to represent as many of the characters that I found when I lived there in the book itself. So it was very much a direct reflection of that.
Another thing on the topic of the book's characters, you often switch perspectives, narrative perspectives. You allow many of the characters to be the speakers for moments of the book. And there is a scene at the hairdresser's where one of the women working there, Darla, she says to some of the other people there that she's writing a novel, and she mentions to one of them, Louisa, you would be a background character. Uh-huh. And of course, meanwhile, Darla herself is maybe can be considered a background character in your novel.
That's right.
But one of the things that's so wonderful about your novel is the way that some of the characters who might just be background characters are given some time. For instance, there's Ted, the owner of the 24-hour store, whose dog is attacked relatively early on in the book, and then he reappears later on, and we get some insight into his life. I thought that that was really wonderful. What was the thought process behind doing that?
I was having a bit of fun, I think. It was just plain entertainment value at first. But then when I realized that I was interested in the characters who were walking by the other characters, I thought, well, what does that say about our lives? A writing professor of mine, Michael Cunningham, once said that every subordinate character is the main character of a different story.
Right.
And that stuck with me. It stuck with me for years. And when I identified the structure of this novel, I realized that I wanted to write the novel that had all of the heroes from other stories included, and that would allow them to have their say as well.
And one of the other things about the structure of the novel is the time demarcations. We start off and it's 7 a.m. on Christmas Eve Eve, and as someone might guess from the title of the book, we are eventually going to get to 2 a.m. And that's something that I think is very effective and enjoyable as you're reading the book, to have that pace with the time throughout the day.
7 p.m. It is dark, dark 7 p.m. on Christmas Eve Eve. The city gathers its black-skirted taxis around the ankles of Rittenhouse Square. A vendor rolls his cart into the park. Pinwheels hem and sigh in flower pots stuffed with foam. Every audience in every theater on Broad Street leans forward into the hyphen of silence between the overture and Act One. A couple necks in the back seat of a Honda parked at 13th and Spruce.
I've had people email me and friends who have texted me saying, I'm almost at 2 a.m. and I'm dying to know what is going to happen. I have to put the book down because I'm freaking out. I'm so worried that something is going to happen to Madeleine. I did not anticipate that sense of dread as the reader reached, you know, got closer and closer to 2 a.m. For me, it was just a way of structuring the book that was interesting and that I enjoyed and that would stay true to the ideas I was trying to get across about what life is really like every day.
And for me, it didn't feel, I didn't have a sense of dread with that. Maybe it was a suspense because I think I had a sense that something good was coming, or certainly that these characters would be meeting. Mm-hmm. And it was just a sense of excitement about what will it be that brings them together.
I had a list of things that could happen at 2 a.m. because I had the title before I knew what would happen at that point, and you should see some of the things I had on that list. Alien invasion, everyone dies, like police sting, everyone turns out to be dead, a la Sixth Sense. And eventually I wanted to hit that kind of middle distance mm-hmm. that I feel, you know, life actually exists in,
right,
where it's not really, really great and it's not really, really bad. It's just everyday kind of thing.
Speaking of everyday kind of things, I loved the scene where Sarina goes to her friend, or sort of friend, Georgie's house for dinner. Mm-hmm. And the conversation that the group of dinner guests have is so funny and so spot on, just the rhythms of their conversation and the way that she's excited about telling a story, the way Sarina wants to tell a story about Madeleine, but she's sort of prevented from doing that. I loved that scene. I thought it was just perfect.
To life, Michael lifts his glass. To life, the party responds. Dinner begins. The plate of bread circumnavigates the table. The table is round, so no one sits at the head. Or everyone does, Michael thinks, slicing into the butter. Because it is a good dinner party, food is beside the point. Who cares what Georgie served? Vegetable lasagna, an heirloom, whatnot, a breathtaking salad. Sarina taps salt from a reindeer shaker. Salt, she says, is a combination of sodium and chloride. They are considered the bad boys of the periodic table. I learned that from our science teacher. It is also what you give people who've recently moved into a house, Ben says, for luck in fertility, or a seasoned life, one of those. Claudia gives a clipped ha-ha. Who can afford a house? I bought a house, Michael says, but it's more to keep up with the Joneses. Bella wavers on her choice of bread, but commits. How long have you been back in the city, Sarina? Not even a year. Weren't you living someplace fabulous and foreign? Connecticut, Sarina says. It's no surprise you're back. Michael spoons potatoes onto his plate. This city has the highest recidivism rate in America. What does that word mean? Georgie says. It means you have no options. Ben salts his salad. You can't get away, no matter how hard you try. Whatever happened to that guy you dated for so long, Sarina? Bella says, as if the thought has just occurred to her. I married him. You could have brought him, Georgie pouts. Where is he tonight? Sarina swallows a throatful of greens. Divorced. The party flicks their eyes to her, to their plates. Georgie keeps Serena's gaze for the length of a curt, kind nod. Ben traces the lip of his wine glass. Where did that come from, the whole keeping up with the Joneses thing? The saying? Bella waves her knife as if this were an obvious question. It's a metaphor for consumerism. But why is it so hard to keep up with them, specifically? Because they keep buying new shit, Bella says. But who are the Joneses? He persists. Michael wags an asparagus spear at Ben. Everyone in my office. Everyone is the Joneses, Bella says. Michael's office, ex-boyfriends, even we are the Joneses. So, Georgie concludes, we are all trying to keep up with ourselves. So
that was actually based on a dance piece I saw many years ago that was just the entirety of a dinner party, all of the archetypes of a dinner party. And I thought, since this book does go from 7 a.m. one day to 7 a.m. the following day, what if at the 7 p.m. hour the book itself sat down to have a meal? And so I presented that dinner party in its entirety for me to kind of say, like, this is in real time. These people would be talking about this at this time. You know, someone shows up with a gift of wine and then spends too long explaining it. Sarina wants to tell a story but has to battle off her incredible insecurity, and then she gets distracted and interrupted anyway. Sure. I read from that a lot when I do events, because normally I do events around 7 p.m. and so it's nice to read what would actually be happening in the book.
Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. It was a pleasure.